Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Harold Holzer. I'm the director of Roosevelt House, and on behalf of Jennifer Rabb, the president of Hunter, who will be joining us at this evening's reception, I want to welcome you to this symposium. So I get to be the first one to offer congratulations to Jeff Parsons and CHEST for their extraordinary milestone, 20 years of driving policy with research. And as the panels today will remind us, there is an extraordinary history of research and lobbying and activism here, as well as present needs and future requirements and goals, and you will be hearing from analysts and practitioners and scholars about the history and the future, as you see from your programs. It's really fitting that we're here. For those of you who don't know the building, these are the twin townhouses of Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt. On one side, on the east side, and on the west side, Franklin's mother, Sarah, who built this as a wedding present for Franklin and Eleanor after objecting to their marriage for a while. She gave them the house, and it came with one requirement that she live in the adjoining house. So we call it the first New Deal. She then proceeded, even though there were separate doors and entrances, to cut through the Four Freedoms Room, as we call it now, which is the dining room. You will go there for the reception later. And then cut through another room upstairs, and as Eleanor would say, she was in and out of our house at the most unexpected moments for the rest of our lives. In this twin family house, though, in the library upstairs, Franklin Roosevelt created the New Deal with his staff between November 1932 and March 1933, when he left from this house to assume the presidency. So in this space, not this space, because this was a carve-out from the garden, which is above us, and part of an unbelievable rehabilitation of the house 8 years ago. But from the library, the very modest library upstairs, Franklin Roosevelt and company created the social safety network, the safety net that from which we've been building ever since. Social Security, minimum wage, workman's comp, all thought through upstairs. So in that spirit, we go on to attack social problems, health problems, in truly inspiring space. I do want to remind you that this is going to be a long and exciting symposium, but you are invited to celebrate with us at 6 o'clock upstairs. Don't leave without joining us in a toast to Jeff and CHEST, and hearing from Danny O'Donnell and some other public officials who we hope will stop by, some of whom, like my old friend Dick Gottfried, the chairman of the New York State Assembly Health Committee, needs to be, I mean, he's a great guy, but he needs to be pushed, knowing that there are still issues to tackle. So with that, and with congrats to Jeff, I want to introduce my colleague, Dr. Elizabethe Payne, who is the director of the LGBT Social Science and Public Policy. I never remember to say public policy or public program. She's the gal who runs the LGBT Center at Roosevelt House / Hunter College. So please welcome Elizabethe.
So welcome. I'm sure we will have one or two little technical slowdowns as we go through the day today. As Harold said, I'm Dr. Elizabethe Payne. I'm interim director of the LGBT Social Science and Public Policy Center at Roosevelt House. The LGBT Social Science and Public Policy Center was founded in 2008 by none other than Dr. Jeff Parsons, whose CHEST we also celebrate today. He had a committee of Hunter College faculty who were collectively interested in utilizing their research to improve public policy for LGBT individuals and communities. The center is rooted in interdisciplinary social science and comprised of an executive committee, a Hunter advisory board, CUNY research board, and an active student policy group called EQUIPS. Several of the CHEST faculty that will speak today are members of the board. All board members are social science researchers or policy faculty with expertise in LGBTQ issues or in gender and sexuality more broadly. The mission of the Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, and Transgender Social Science and Public Policy Center is to support social science and policy research on LGBT issues and to inform policy decisions, to disseminate findings, to inform public opinion, and promote LGBT social, health, and political equity, and to provide LGBT policy academic training and practicum opportunities for Hunter students. This symposium today was designed with our mission in mind, to bring social science researchers into dialogue with those working in policy and to support our vision for a cycle of engaged scholarship, research to policy to practice to research. In addition to public symposia such as this one, we also hold book talks with social scientists who are writing on key LGBTQ social issues, brown bags featuring the work of board members, and policy roundtables. Board members serve as experts in policy hearings, consult on the drafting of legislation, produce policy white papers, and teach their students what it means to be an engaged scholar. We also support a student policy group, offer undergraduate classes, and an intensive undergraduate fellowship program. The LGBT Social Science and Public Policy Center is located at Hunter's Casa Lolly at 132 East 65th, two blocks east of Roosevelt House. And you can find us and keep up with our events at Twitter and Facebook, LGBT Policy. And you can email us at the Policy Center, or you can email me directly if you have questions about what we do. As a note, the name of the Policy Center uses LGBT rather than a more expansive list of identities. We often get asked about that. It is in alignment with current policy language at the city, state, federal, and international levels. The research and focus of the faculty affiliated with the LGBT, SS, and PPC includes the Q and many, many initials beyond. So I'm going to exit here. And then I am going to have the honor of introducing Jeff Parsons. So I am really pleased and honored today to be the one that gets to introduce Dr. Jeffrey Parsons. Dr. Parsons is a distinguished professor of psychology at Hunter College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. And he is the founder and director of the Center for HIV/AIDS Educational Studies and Training, CHEST, which we celebrate today, as well as the founder of the LGBT Social Science and Public Policy Center. But before I describe his lengthy contributions and awards, I want us to stop and remember the past. Like many of you in this room, I was there. I remember. The fears, the stigma, the pain, the monumental losses we experienced in the 1980s and 90s as HIV devastated LGBTQ communities, those feelings for me, though decades passed, they're just beneath the surface. So the tears can still really easily come. And as we celebrate CHEST today, it's important to remember that it was then, in that moment, back then, in that culture of fear and stigma where AIDS was whispered, where parents believed their gay son's coming out was a death sentence, that Jeff decided to take up this work. 20 years is a remarkable milestone for CHEST and for Dr. Parsons. But what cannot be listed in a bio is the cultural context of that accomplishment and the strength that it takes to persist in this work. So to Jeff, and to all of you who have been in this work for the decades, today as we talk about HIV research to policy, past, present, and future, thank you for making these conversations possible. So, Dr. Jeff Parsons, founded CHEST in 1996 and continues as its director. He has served as principal investigator on numerous research grants with NIH and CDC, particularly focused on the development and evaluation of behavioral interventions. He has brought in over $55 million in federal grant funding for his research, and he has mentored numerous junior faculty, postdocs, doctoral students, and undergrads, many of whom went on to become the researchers who will be presenting with us today. His current research focuses on sexual risk behaviors among gay and bisexual men, particularly youth, PrEP uptake, the connection between sexual compulsivity and HIV risk behaviors, and interventions to improve HIV medication adherence. He is an expert in the use of motivational interviewing as a strategy of HIV/AIDS-related behavior change. Dr. Parsons joined the Hunter College faculty in 2000 and served as the chair of the Department of Psychology from 2008 to 2010. He served as a member of the White House Office on National AIDS Policy, HIV Age and Aging Workgroup, and is a member of the Social and Behavioral HIV Prevention Research Think Tank by the National Institutes of Health Office on AIDS Research. He served as chair of the Behavioral and Social Consequences of HIV Study section of the National Institutes of Health from 2010 to 2012, and from 2005 to 2007, he was president of the Society for the Scientific Study of Sexuality in the East. He is a fellow of the American Psychological Association, the Society for Behavioral Medicine, and the Society for the Scientific Study of Sexuality. And his many honors include the Distinguished Scientific Achievement Award from APA, the John Money Award from the Society for Scientific Study of Sexuality. He has also been honored by the APA for the outstanding contributions to the advancement of public interest. And he received the Hunter College's Presidential Award for Excellence in Applied Scholarship. So please welcome the founder of CHEST, Dr. Jeff Parsons.
Wow. Well, thank you for that. This is a treat, and I'm honored, I'm humbled, and I'm really proud of everything that CHEST has done in its 20-year history. I'm going to do a brief sort of historical overview of CHEST because I know people have already told me they want to hear the penis guy talk. So to give you a basic sort of overview of the Hunter College Center for HIV Educational Studies and Training, or CHEST, we conduct research to identify and promote strategies that prevent the spread of HIV and improve the lives of people living with HIV. And CHEST was really founded on that latter point. CHEST's first projects were specifically focused on the needs of people living with HIV and addressing the sense of stigma and the sense of loneliness and the sense of isolation and shame that a lot of gay and bisexual men living with HIV were experiencing in the late 90s. And so that really sort of gave birth to the center and to the research and our mission that we have followed ever since. Our work follows a basic sort of structure where we start with formative research, we do a lot of qualitative work, we do a lot of surveys, but the goal of that work is to lead to intervention development, to programs that can actually make a difference and that can help people. We then move into efficacy trials, usually smaller scale, very controlled trials, often in our research center, in which we're able to sort of control a lot of the factors. And then we want to move towards implementation, where we take that work out into the field and make sure that it can work in the real world as well as it works in our research center. We advocate for and work with the LGBT community, and this has also been a focus of ours since the very beginning. Our mantra is sex positive, no judgments. And that's really, I think, one of the things that has solidified our connection and our trust on behalf of the community. The community knows that we are a sex-positive organization. We are not going to tell people that they shouldn't be having sex. We like sex. We advocate for sex. We want people to have healthy sexuality and healthy, satisfying sex lives. So I look at CHEST's 20 years as coming from sort of five eras. We've had some logo development over the course of the time. I like to think of the first few years as our infancy. Then we had some toddler years, childhood, adolescence, and I think we're now moving into adulthood, which is very difficult for me because I don't really want to be an adult. This was the beginning of CHEST. Literally, there were four of us. That was our associate provost at New Jersey City University, where CHEST was founded originally. That was 1996. I'm happy to say that all four of the original CHESTicles are here in this room today. And I believe that Joe Bruno, who was the associate provost at the time, is actually coming later on today. So I'm hopeful that we can recreate that picture. Of course, all of us are a little older and some of us a lot fatter. But it's nice to go through and look at what we looked like before children and 20 years ago. So in our infancy years, we did a lot of projects. And we really, as I said, focused on seropositive populations really before the whole prevention for positive movement became a thing. We were one of the first researchers to really emphasize understanding the needs of people living with HIV, and it's something that I'm particularly proud of. We conducted the first federally funded study of HIV-positive, gay, bisexual, and other men who have sex with men. That was kind of challenging because it was a time in history when politics played a big role, and so it was difficult, but the CDC funded a study to really try to understand the needs of these men, and we were happy to sort of be at the forefront and be part of it. We also did the first study of gay male sex workers on the internet and really tried to blend formative research with intervention trials to kind of understand the full picture of what's going on. So then we moved into our toddler years and we moved to Hunter College at the beginning. We moved here in 2000 and we started to really focus a lot on the role of alcohol and other drug use in relation to risk behaviors and in relation to keeping healthy living with HIV. And so that became a major focus of this era in CHESS history. We also developed really strong connections with colleagues and investigators at Mount Sinai and at New York University. So then we moved into childhood and we took what I sort of view as a more contextual focus to our work, really trying to understand what factors were driving sexual risk and substance use behaviors. So we looked at things like sexual compulsivity. We looked at things like venues where people meet their sex partners and the role of the internet, which was obviously becoming a big deal at this point. We also started to focus a lot on day-level associations between things like drug use and risky sex. So instead of looking in general, what are people doing with their sex? And in general, what are they doing with their substance use? On a day-to-day level, how do those two behaviors interact and what's the connection? And that's really led to, I think, a lot of our innovative intervention designs by focusing on those connections. So we also moved to new space in 2012. This was with President Robb and former Provost Vita Rabinowitz, who's now the Vice Chancellor of CUNY. This was, for many years, CHEST was in a space in Chelsea on 26th Street that was designed to hold 20 people. When we had 40, it had one working bathroom for everybody, including participants. So if it was a busy day with participants, you could wait 2 or 3 hours to get to use the bathroom. So our new space is not like that. It's actually quite modern. It was designed for our specifications to be exactly what we need, and it has multiple bathrooms, which is, I know, a source of joy among the staff. So at this point in our studies, we really broadened our focus with new methodologies. Most excitingly, I think we broadened our focus with new investigators. As Elizabeth said, a lot of the folks who started out as CHEST interns, CHEST undergraduate students, graduate students, postdocs, now moving into having their own NIH funding and their own grants going through CHEST, and so really contributing their own sort of intellectual pieces to our mission and to the scope of our work in a way that I think has really moved us forward and keeps our momentum going. We've also deepened connections with colleagues in other places. We continue to have associations with Mount Sinai, but now we have very strong relationships with Northwestern University, the University of Minnesota, and Wayne State University. Moving on, we have a lot going on just starting this year. In fact, just the last couple of months have been quite busy for us. The Young Men's Health Project, which I'll be talking about a little bit later in the program, we have an implementation trial now to test this intervention for young gay and bisexual men in two New York City-based, community-based organizations, Boom Health and Harlem United. So we're gonna get to, again, really focus on that implementation piece and see how what we tested in a controlled setting works in the real world when delivered by real world providers. We also just got a $9.3 million grant with our colleagues at Northwestern to look at particularly young gay, bisexual, and other men who have sex with men, ages 13 to 18, to really see if we can put together online and mHealth-based interventions to reduce their risk of HIV, but also to help them sort of come to terms with their sexual identity and sexual debut, so that hopefully they'll move into becoming sexually active, already knowing the information and education that could be really important to maintaining their sexual health. And then literally last week, we were awarded part of the Adolescent HIV Trials Network, a new grant that will be 5 years for us to develop a network that we call Scale It Up, which is all about taking interventions that have been shown efficacious and implementing them on a broader scale. Again, all focused on youth, 13 to 24, both HIV positive and HIV negative. We're also doing a lot of focus on Truvada and PrEP, as it's commonly known. There's a whole session later this afternoon on PrEP. We're moving into this area not just focused on sort of getting people on PrEP and then getting them to adhere to PrEP, which seems to be the major focus. We really want to take a step back and look at what motivates people to even think about it and consider it. One of our presenters today is going to talk about some of that work, looking at kind of a PrEP cascade, if you will. And then the introduction of mHealth becomes a really major focus of what we do, and I think the future directions that we're going to be moving into. We've just developed a relationship with Scruff that will allow us to embed surveys in their software platform so that we can work together collaboratively to understand sort of what's going on in real time with large national samples of men who use this app. So we're really excited about some of the future developments and work that can come out of these kinds of partnerships. We've come a long way in terms of our grant funding history. This year, we are just about hitting the $6 million mark in grant funding. So it's been this slide shows the 16 years that we've been at Hunter in terms of our grant development. So what does 20 years and $55 million buy? Well, over 300 peer-reviewed publications have come out of the work at CHEST. Over 300 students have interned at CHEST, and this is something that I'm really, really proud of. Undergrads, Hunter undergrads, other CUNY schools, students from other schools who find out about the work that we're doing and want to join and be part of it. 11 independently funded NIH researchers have come out of the CHEST work. 12 LRP-funded researchers, 13 postdoctoral fellowships, 4 international visiting scholars, 3 NRSA-funded predoctoral fellowships, 45 undergraduate theses, 18 master's theses, 11 PhD dissertations, and we have 8 current PhD students. This is what I'm really excited about. Obviously, our work is critical and important and all of that, but from my perspective, really training and nurturing the next generation of people who are going to continue to do this important work is absolutely essential and part of our mission. I need to thank a lot of people. My co-director for many years, Perry Halkidis at New York University, as well as my co-director for many years here at Hunter, Sarit Golub. They both played very important roles in CHEST development and evolution through the years. I want to thank Elizabethe and the LGBT Social Science and Public Policy Center for organizing this, arranging it, doing a lot of the legwork so that I could continue to write grants and do those kinds of things while they organized this amazing symposium. The folks here at Roosevelt House, who have been wonderful in sort of walking me through this process, having never done one of these, it's been wonderful, and we've felt very taken care of throughout the entire process. I always like to thank our president. She is an amazing advocate for the work that we do. She is our biggest cheerleader, our biggest supporter, and we have been blessed the whole time that we've been at Hunter to be under her leadership. And so it's really wonderful how she takes care of us and how she respects and recognizes the work we do, even at times when it's politically not so good because of, you know, people finding out that we're studying penis size and not necessarily liking that as much as you all might. Finally, I want to thank my husband of 26 years. Yes, that is me with a mullet. I also want to thank our 10-year-old son. God help you if you are raised by gay sex researchers, because this picture will just continue to haunt you for the rest of your life. And if he knew I was showing this, he would be mortified. But my family makes it possible for me to do the work that I do and have the support at home that I need to function. And so I thank them very much. And the Chesticles, the most amazing team of people that I have been blessed to work with. And again, I'm particularly excited that so many of them are here to present today, and we all get to hear the exciting work that they've done and the contributions that they've made to CHEST over its 20-year history. Thank you. So it's now my privilege to introduce our moderator for the day, Mark King. Mark King comes to us from Atlanta. He has a wonderful blog. If you're not familiar with it, I would urge you to look at it, called My Fabulous Disease. And we also heard earlier that Mark has a long history, both as an HIV/AIDS activist, as an educator, and I would say his sort of focus on, again, addressing the needs of people living with HIV and trying to deal effectively with some of the shame and stigma and issues that come to play has been really impressive. And the way that he does that and utilizes social media for that is really incredible. So without further ado, Mark.
Thank you. I don't have slides. I'm a walking slide. It's all right. Thank you so much. I am so thrilled and honored and excited to be here and to introduce the speakers you're about to have and have a conversation with them about the work that they're doing. Quickly about me, all you need to know about me is this. I am a gay, HIV-positive drug addict in recovery, or as my mother likes to say, what's not to love? And I carry that with me, all of those identities in March of 1985, the very first HIV test came out, the very first test to find out about this new virus that had only been identified within the last year. I got a phone call from my friend, the nurse, who secretly gave me this brand new test to tell me that I was positive and good luck. And that was the environment I lived in, a very, very, very scary time. But I am not a tragic victim. I am a happy, fulfilled gay man who embraces my husband and our sex life and life in general, and I wake up grateful every single day, especially on days like this, because I get to be here for such great celebration and for the work that you're doing. I cannot tell you, you know, it's like I am your end user. You know, for a lot of the work that you've done. You know, you talked about how you've started focusing on gay men like me with HIV, and how do we deal, you know? So on behalf of me and all my brothers out there, thank you very much. So we are gonna dive right into this. We have five presenters for the past of CHEST. Oh, and by the way, you didn't just found one organization. Can I just say this? Didn't you also found the other one, the LGBT policy? I mean, that's just showing off. Here we have the following five, and I'm just going to ask you to wave, and then you're going to be presenting one by one, and then we're going to have a conversation with you. The first man of the hour is Dr. Kristen Grove. Say hello, Kristen. Good. Well done. You follow direction well. Okay. I am. You. Their bios are in your program, and they're very extremely impressive. But I'm not going to go into details now. I'm going to tell you some a couple of things I found especially interesting. You're associate professor of the Department of Community Health and Social Sciences at CUNY. That's terrific. But I really love the fact that you do a lot of work on the intersection of substance abuse and HIV. It's also true, as I understand it, that you'll be giving a presentation. Okay, let me get this right. the role of penis size in HIV-STD prevention. My interest in this symposium has just risen precipitously, and funny enough, you know, it goes uphill from there. They get even better even from there. This is, you know, we're not front loading this, I promise you. So thank you for being here. Secondly, Dr. David Bimby. David, say hello.
Hi, Christian.
Professor and Director of Health and Human Services in the Health Sciences at LaGuardia Community College. You talked about, Jeff, how several people started their work as an intern here. You are one of those. Is that right? You began your career as an undergraduate peer counselor. And that was 20 years ago. You've been doing two decades of research since. Welcome home. And thanks for being here. Dr. Anna Ventuniak. Anna. Say hello. Professor in the Department of Medicine, Infectious Diseases, and Director of HIV Behavioral Health at the, how do you say, Icon School? Medicine at Mount Sinai. And again, you integrate substance abuse services to detect and treat HIV-positive patients. So again, substance abuse, I'm all about that. I'm a triple threat. Gay, HIV-positive, substance abuse, pardon?
I started at CHEST.
Oh, and you also started at CHEST. This is like home week. That's terrific. Then we have Jeff, who will also be on our panel later. You know all about him. And then our discussant is going to be Dr. James Tesorario. Hi, that's James right there. James is the director of the New York State Department of Health's AIDS Institute. And not only are you doing research on maximizing New York State's data to care initiative, I like the fact that you're doing a lot of work in prisons. And thank you again for being here. So those are our presenters and our discussants, and we are going discussant. And we're going to dive right in and start with Dr. Kristen Grove and his presentation on size does matter. Okay, perhaps it does. The role of penis size in HIV-STD prevention. Please welcome him.
Talk about a big tease. I said big tease. So hi, everyone. I'm Christian Grove. I'm an associate professor in community health and social science at the CUNY School of Public Health. And I've been collaborating with the folks at CHEST for the last 13 years. I started as a volunteer back in 2003. And the talk that I'm giving stems from some side work that we've done where we posed questions to people about penis size and condom use. Jeff, I want to say thank you and congratulations. I never thought that I would be in Theodore Roosevelt's house talking about gay men's penises, but here I am today. Franklin. I'm sorry, Franklin, the other one. So we've published a couple of papers on penis size, and I can't go into all the work that we've done, so I'm just going to touch on some of the surface of a little bit. Of it. This is our most recent paper looking at the association between race and penis size, which I won't be talking about today. Speak to me during the reception. We've gotten in trouble for our work as well. There are people from the NIH here too, and they all know me by name as a result of this. And we've also looked at people's experience with the New York City condom, which I'm also unfortunately not going to be able to talk about today. Our work has been picked up by the popular media in both good ways and bad ways. So here was an article in Psychology Today by Brian Mastansky looking at the value of our work. Here's a misinterpretation of our research. We published on gay men, and I think Cosmo picked it up, and it was like, ladies, beware. when, of course, Fox News got a hold of the work that we were doing, so you can imagine the direction that went. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about why it's important to look at penis size or the stereotypes that exist with regard to its whether it is or not association with stereotypes regarding power, stamina, fertility, social status, social desirability, attractiveness, comfort in a swimsuit. But what I will say is that the reason that we approach it is we felt that it might be related to the acquisition of HIV and STIs, and specifically as penis size may relate to correct and consistent condom use, condom fit and condom feel, slippage and condom breakage, and as well as, to put it bluntly, covering all the vital areas. So we did two studies. I'm going to talk about two of our studies today, one that we did in 2006 and one that we did in 2010. And I think what's important to note is both of these are pre-PrEP studies, so a lot of our implications from this work is pre-PrEP. I can speak to about post-PrEP. Annually, for many years, we were doing a community-based survey here in New York City, and I'm going to present data from the 2006 and 2010 surveys at large-scale GLBT events. We dressed in drag to get people to fill out our survey. That's us in the cab on the way over. Jeff, David, and I'm the pretty one in the center. And everyone that filled out our survey, we gave them a movie ticket for compensation. So, and I'm not going to be able to talk about everything that we did with each of these surveys, but in 2006, we asked people to ask to tell us if they were below average, average, above average, whether they lied to others about their penis size, their satisfaction with their penis, and then most of all, lifetime history of STI diagnosis, the number of sex partners. That is, does having a bigger penis or a smaller penis get you laid more? Whether they were experiencing condomless sex and whether what their sexual position was. Is it top, bottom, or versatile? We also measured lots of things around well-being, but I also can't talk about that today. In 2010, we fixed our measure a little bit. So instead of asking people, do you feel you're above average, below average, whatever, we gave people response choices that were more quantifiable. In hindsight, I wish that we would have given people more granular responses as well, because the, for instance, for length, most people just checked off 6 to 8 inches, but we don't know where exactly they are in there. And this is a paper and pencil survey, so we weren't at a place where we could have somebody drag on a scale or whatever. And then also with circumference, we asked participants as well. And for questions like, for my penis length, the average or typical condom is too short, just right, too long. For my girth, it's too tight, just right, too loose. And finding condoms that fit me is easy, difficult. And then, of course, we asked him about condomless anal sex and the experience of condom slippage and condom breakage. Here's the fun stuff. So in the 2006 survey, 56% of our participants felt that their penis size was average. Very few felt that they were below average, so people, you know, feel good about themselves. 65% of participants were satisfied with their size. One-third said that they wanted a larger penis. Size was not associated with condom use in the last 90 days in this survey. So regardless of whether you felt that you were above or below, you were reporting condom use the same as other people. And it was not related to the number of sex partners that someone reported. So having a larger or smaller penis was not associated with getting laid more. And it was not associated with lifetime or recent hep B, hep C, syphilis, scabies, crabs, or lice. We did find, however, that it was related to skin-to-skin STIs that are virally transmitted. So people with above-average penises were more likely to report having genital warts and genital herpes. And we believe, we don't have the data on it, but we believe that this could be a result of the condom not covering all the vital areas during sex. And it was associated with sexual positioning in ways that, you know, maybe contribute to sexual pleasure, but from an anatomical standpoint, to prevent injury during sex or transmission of STIs, not in a way that we would want it to be, for instance. In 2010, we found that 51% of participants were in what we would call the average range, meaning 6 to 8 inches. Only 6% said that they had never measured their length. And I think for a public health standpoint, what it tells us, if we want to approach gay men and offer them condoms in particular sizes, they're going to know what size that they need because they have measured. 1 in 5 people had never measured their circumference. What I will say is that the people that had measured their circumference were more likely to report, okay, were more likely to report that they experienced condoms are often tight on them. So those two were associated with each other. 71% of participants felt that the average or typical condom was just right for them. 28% of participants then that means had some other response. 61% of participants felt with regard to girth it was just right, 38% said some other response. Only 38% of participants said that finding a condom that fits them is easy. 31%, I think this is actually very high, in the prior 3 months, 31% reported condom breakage, 42% reported condom slippage, which could be, for instance, the condom coming off during sex or when during withdrawal the condom comes off. Penis length was positively associated with penis circumference, difficulty finding condoms that fit, and condom breakage. Penis length and penis circumference were inversely associated with finding, I'm saying that the average condom was too long or too loose. All of this makes sense. Nothing is a surprise here. If you're somewhere outside of what, you know, a normal range, you report problems finding condoms that fit you. And there was a positive association between difficulty finding condoms that fit and reporting condom breakage and condom slippage. And a positive association between condom breakage and condom slippage. So people that are experiencing errors in problems in one area were experiencing problems in another. And I'll say this, so in contrast to our 2006 study, in 2010, condomless anal sex was positively associated with penis size. So in our prior study, the two weren't related, whereas in this later study, they were. So I think it gives us some pause to think about this a little bit more. And men who reported condomless anal sex were more likely to report that the average or typical condom was too tight for them. So some mixed findings there as well, though we didn't ask about condom fit and condom feel in the first study. So what do I want you to take home from this? Well, most men felt that they fell within an average range, and condom distribution programs like the New York City condom distribution program, you're all familiar with the NYC condom, yay, at this point, can meet the needs of these individuals. What it also tells us, though, is that these, you know, large-scale programs shouldn't be one-size-fits-all, that there are people who fall on one side or another side of the range, and that our departments of health or whoever's distributing free condoms should make them available in a variety of sizes. And I'll commend the New York City Department of Health for doing just that. In 2006, size was not related to condomless anal sex, but it was in 2010. This tells us that size may matter when it comes to condomless anal sex, and it certainly mattered when it came to viral skin-to-skin STIs. And like I mentioned earlier, lots of men have measured, which I think is a good sign for us if we're trying to find a match between a condom that's going to fit someone and them. And I'll say that, you know, we've gotten in trouble for our work. The Traditional Values Coalition trolled NIH reporter to look for titles of studies that it felt were controversial. I happened to be a postdoc when I wrote up the findings of our 2010 study, and they got a hold of that and attributed the funding that the postdoctoral fellowship had received for the past 10 years, it was like $10 million, to being given to me so that I could run around bathhouses and measure gay men's penises. None of which I did, but I would have loved to. And I'll also just mention that condoms are considered a medical device, so there's very strict regulation that they fall under with regard to offering, you know, different shapes, sizes, and textures or whatever. And I think theyfit.com is a great example of it, where they offered size-to-fit condoms to individuals, but they lost their FDA approval and are still fighting for that today. Thank you.
Thank you, Christian. Please welcome next Dr. David Bimby. His presentation is Before Drag Race, Evaluating Community Interventions for MSM Using Innovative Community-Based Research Methods. Thanks.
Oh, that's about the mic. Sorry. I think I'm teaching. Sorry. I'm one of those teachers that does laps in the classroom. Anyway, good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to thank Christian for the foreplay today, because I'm going to continue on some of the things that he brought up in his talk. But I want to talk about, we called this Before Drag Race, using innovative interventions for the MSM communities and our research methods. So I'm going to give you a little overview of sort of how this all started. So before Drag Race, we had the biggest mess. And the biggest mess was part of the summit intervention funded by the CDC, series of workshops, positive MSM would come in, and one of the sessions was a beauty pageant featuring your favorite contestants from Ms. Crystal Meth to Ali Kohal and others. And the contestants used this as a jumping off point to have discussions in small groups to talk about the relationship between drugs and HIV risk behavior. It was very successful. We actually turned it into a DVD several years later. Please pick one up at the door. No. To show you how our work sort of creates threads, even though we don't think we see threads between the individual projects at work, how things tend to feed off of one another. While we were doing this intervention for the summit project, the cast had a lot of downtime, and we would sit around while the men were in their discussion groups, and one day we got it in our heads to grab safe sex kits, and we were in Chelsea, and we decided to do drag-bys, and we would just run through 8th Avenue throwing condoms at people. There's a photograph of me stopping traffic somewhere. It turned out that the bar owners were letting us in because we were dressed in drag, and people were stopping to talk to us because we were dressed in drag. And we felt that we kind of landed on something, which then led to the creation of the Drag Initiative to Vanquish AIDS, otherwise known as the Divas. And the Divas debuted at Wigstock on Labor Day 2001, just days before 9/11, ironically and coincidentally. And over time, the Divas became quite popular. Here we are handing out condoms in Bryant Park for the Gay Pride Rally. Here we are with a wax figure of RuPaul, because she would not pose with us for real. Again, this is from the Gay Life Expo, which we're going to talk about in just a second. There's Professor Grove, right? We got some local press here and there. The Divas were not professional drag queens, but we wound up in the local gay press every once in a while. We appeared at Hunter College as hostesses for a showing of The Education of Shelby Knox, and were quite well received standing there in the corridor of Hunter handing out condoms to folks. We were the MCs at the Pride March for 7 years running, something crazy, like 7 years we were the official MCs at the Pride March, 42nd Street. And then eventually Heritage of Pride actually recognized the Divas with a Volunteer of a Year award in 2005 because it seemed that we were in drag every week. But you could see your squirrel, right? I see your squirrel. Okay. The Divas. The Divas turned out to be quite popular during that time. We had many community partners. We worked with GMHC, and the Divas were invited to host us at GMHC events, and we used that opportunity to recruit for research studies. New York City Department of Health had an initiative called Hot Shots, where they were doing on-site STI HIV testing in gay bars, and the Divas worked with them as the hostess of the event to encourage men to partake of services. Heritage of Pride, Body Positive, Hive, which was a social organization for positive men about a decade or so ago. Fairgrounds, we were at Great Adventure, that's us on the roller coaster holding our wigs. And Will Clark Productions, who is a local producer who invited us for many years to appear at all his events. But today I want to pick up on what Christian mentioned about the Sex and Love Study, that we recruited people at these large events in New York City annually. I said to 2008 because that's the year I stopped being in charge. And we also did LA in 2004. And it was a basic survey that included demographics, you know, and the typical behaviors we would ask of gay and bisexual men, sexual risk, drug use, and things such as that. As an annual survey, the staff would... And then Dr. Parsons would get together and decide what are we going to ask this year that might serve as pilot data for future grant applications. And one year we had this idea that there was a lot of PSAs going on around different issues in the gay community. So what we decided to do was take a corner of the survey and ask folks, had you seen these ads, had you heard these things, and sort of do a quick impression of what the response was to these public health information campaigns aimed at MSM in the large cities. So we went out to LA, we had a wonderful time. Dr. Parsons was bi-coastal at that time, and we had all our goods shipped to his home in LA. And we went to the events in Los Angeles, and it was this Stop the Sores campaign had been going on in LA for a couple of years. They used Phil the Syphilis Sore. Another alternative of this campaign was called the Happy Penis, that used a large rubber penis to sort of promote STI and specifically syphilis testing. But the goals weren't to increase awareness, but there had been one informal evaluation, so what we decided to do was ask folks, had you seen these ads? And this is an example of the advertisements that were part of the campaign. I love the one, Are You Sleeping with Phil? Right.
and the palm cards. And actually, when we were out there, the divas actually did street recruitment with Phil the Syphilis Sore. They were doing on street, their street testing in a mobile van. And if I recall, the line was, "Hey, honey, you want to come to the party? It's in the van." Quite good. And we'll talk a little bit more about how effective or what the impact of that was later. So here's what we did. So we sampled almost 600 folks. When we dropped the folks who didn't have the LA zip codes, we got below six. We asked them. We had a good racial mix representing the LA area. And the self-reported HIV status seemed to indicate what you would we consider to be prevalence rates in the MSM community, close enough. And we showed, included a picture of Phil the Syphilis Sore and asked whether folks had seen him. And we saw about almost a 60% recognition rate. And those who saw it, we asked them, how did you feel about this campaign? And it was very simple. These ads made me think about my behavior, want to learn more, be more selective, think about getting tested, wanting to talk to my friends, and then actually, did they get tested? And you see the numbers are really trending in all the directions that we would like to see them. We did find some unique differences within the sample, and I'm gonna bring this up again later, is that we found out that men of color were more likely to agree to the statement about wanting to talk to their friends. And I think that's an interesting finding that can form the basis of future public health outreach campaigns, seeing that folks of that community were more likely to agree with that. And then we saw that positive men, white men, and men who actually reported risk behavior were more likely to say or that they went for syphilis testing after exposure to the campaign. So you could summarize that the campaign was quite effective, and I don't have it in these slides, but the local data seemed to indicate that when the campaign ended, that syphilis rates kind of rebounded. So for New York, at New York about that time, there was a lot of activism going around crystal meth because it became a source of concern, and we have to thank Peter Staley, who was also one of the original ACT UP activists who then formed the Treatment Action Group, who then took it upon himself to pay for these telephone booth ads up and down 8th Avenue, and it really created a dialogue. People were kind of horrified, had lots of disagreements, particularly about the, you know, get your crystal pipe and get HIV free kind of tagline was very provocative for a lot of folks. But the conversation started. So the grassroots picked up and the HIV forum was created and they did several public forums and info sessions and they designed their own awareness campaign showing you the contrast in 10 years that people are now sitting by their laptops smoking crystal looking for their next hookup. GMHC started sponsoring their campaigns as well. And at one point, the divas got interviewed on the street, and we appeared in the first 5 minutes of the Rock Bottom documentary, and I'm mouthing off about how the bathhouses used to be fun, and now they're all filled with people tweaked out. That's what made the cut. I signed a release. That's what happens. So here is our evaluation of the meth campaign. Again, we had a little bit of a larger sample. The ethnic breakdown sort of represents the diversity of New York City, similar self-reported rates of HIV status, and we just asked folks, have you seen any of these ads? And again, we saw a good response rate of 60% of the participants indicating they had seen them. We asked very similar, getting ahead of myself, we're hour about crystal, so we should give you some data on crystal. 20% of the community indicating ever use, one-time use would count there. Recent use, almost 10%. I think that data's gone down in the past couple years. But we did see that positive men were likely to report ever using meth with sex. And who was more likely to see the campaign? Again, similar to syphilis, the folks it was targeted at actually reported seeing it. So folks who ever used meth, recent use, or recent PMP were more likely to say that they had seen the ad. And then we get to the assessment of the impact. And we see similarly again that it did have the intended effects. White men and negative men more likely to agree with statements about not wanting to use or cut down. White men and negative men and folks who reported not having PMP or party and drugs and sex play said they were glad someone was doing something. And then we see the intended impact. And then again, want to get help from crystal, avoid starting use. 36%, that's a nice number to see of folks be concerned or saying that the campaign had some sort of impact on them. So what did we learn through all of this? Well, humor is effective. That's a statement we often make. Humor is effective. It helps us deal with threatening topics in a less threatening way, and specifically when it comes to health promotion behaviors. The divas have been very successful in recruitment strategy for years. The divas, no one says no to a drag queen with a clipboard holding movie tickets, or, you know, even if they don't want your condom and they go ew and they throw it on the street, you at least have a chance to engage in a conversation with folks. Hot Shots and Stop the Sores both reported back to us that their usage rates went up whenever the divas were their hostesses, which is always nice to hear. But not all stakeholders are open to it. Some bars and clubs, the HIV stuff is a, you know, is a killer. It's a, you know, it's going to kill the crowd, or reunite in drag, and people have different political attitudes about drag. So that came up here and there. But the good news is that the LGBT and HIV, AIDS, and CBOs all bought in. So we had lots of community partners. And presently, now we have our nationally known drag queens coming in. So now we have divas as the intervention, if you will, and we now have the cast of RuPaul's Drag Race filming PSAs aimed at the MSM community. This is Bob, the drag queen who won, and this was a little video that Bob released just in the last summer over about using PrEP, and I just read last week that three of the contestants from RuPaul Drag Race have now filmed anti-smoking PSAs aimed at the LGBT community, primarily MSM. So I think what we're saying is we started it, and we're going to pass the ball off to the professionals now, and maybe we should have a Diva Hall of Fame and invite them to be one of us. And then, of course, we are now in the Inferior Illusions Lounge because we cannot hold a candle to the girls at Drag Race. Thank you.
Thank you so much, David. Thank you especially for all of that work around crystal meth and gay men. I often refer to it as our other epidemic. Our next speaker will be Dr. Anna Ventuniak. Her presentation is Making It Routine, Integrating Substance Abuse Treatment and Prevention into HIV Care.
So I want to thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. I want to say that I am very appreciative to have been part of the CHESS family. Everyone at CHESS works very, very hard to do a lot of great work, and I'm really happy to have the opportunity to share with you one of our projects that has really evolved into another, and both are being implemented at Mount Sinai. So to truly appreciate the relevance of these projects, we need to have some context about the relationship between research and policy. And Clancy and colleagues, while at the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, describe the complex relationship between health services researchers and policymakers. And on the surface, they often seem like they're locked in an unrequited love affair. Each seeks the attention and respect of the other, and each is endlessly frustrated. And in fact, this is an image that often is used to depict the relationship between science and policy or practice. And the gorge actually represents the divide between the two. And this image has been used to depict the pipeline of work from research to practice and all of the different steps that are involved in prioritizing research, coming up with ideas, submitting grant proposals, conducting the study, doing data collection, and eventually getting them into practice. And often, research will add to our body of knowledge around what is known, what are the gaps, and what can be done to address certain problems. While other research projects are used to really transform a specific policy if those findings are disseminated widely and relevant to policymakers, and especially if they're timely. Now, NIH has outlined a roadmap to address the science and practice gap, and this smaller image there, you find the researcher and policymaker sort of running across a bridge to embrace each other. Basically, the pathways, as outlined by NIH, really involve basic research, intervention development, trials to determine an intervention's efficacy, replication of those interventions in community settings, effectiveness trials, and then dissemination and implementation research. And so that's a really long process. Now, if we consider key developments in HIV research from the time when cases were first identified to developments in testing, treatment, and prevention options, and to where we are today with the goal of ending the AIDS epidemic, the research being conducted at CHEST has been at the forefront of development and has made many strides in bridging the science and practice gap. From study to understand behavior, as we've already heard about, including sexual behavior and correlates of sexual risk-taking, substance use, and the role of various factors, including HIV disclosure, to intervention development, focusing on motivational interviewing and cognitive behavioral therapy, and focusing specifically on vulnerable groups who are at high risk of HIV infection, like young men, to uptake and acceptability of biomedical prevention strategies such as PrEP. And we'll hear about that more in more detail later. So to sort of summarize, CHEST generates policy-relevant evidence. But CHEST also provides evidence to support policy development through the efficacy trials that have been conducted and through the effectiveness trials that are now testing those interventions that showed some effect to testing them in real-world circumstances. So I have the opportunity today to really share just a brief snapshot of a project that has really evolved. Project Plus was the first behavioral intervention for HIV-positive individuals with alcohol problems to demonstrate significant effects. It was tested in a randomized control trial back in July of 2002 through August 2005. It was funded by NIAAA. And to give you a sense about the importance and relevance of that intervention today, it is applicable even today. Nationally, about 10% of a person's 12 years age or older report past month use of a substance. 6.5% report heavy drinking. And about 8% are classified as possibly having a substance use disorder in the past year. But when we look at HIV-positive persons, these issues are much more prevalent among HIV-positive individuals, where we have estimates of about 5 to 33% of individuals considered hazardous drinkers, nearly 25% report illicit drug use, and 8 to 45% could meet some criteria for substance abuse. And a lot of research has shown that drug use and heavy alcohol consumption adversely impacts medication adherence, HIV disease progression, as well as other conditions. So PLUS was designed to address some of these issues, and it's guided by the IMB. It integrates two complementary techniques to improve motivation and skills, and the sessions are really aimed to improve medication adherence and reduce alcohol consumption. The original intervention consisted of 8 sessions, with session 1 beginning with motivational interviewing to engage patients about their own goals. Sessions 3 through 7 really involved skill building so that people could recognize triggers and or really develop coping skills. Session 8 considered a review of the treatment process as well as talking with people about their own relapse and maintenance plans. Plus, the efficacy trial showed a clinical improvement compared to a education control condition. So again, this was conducted at CHEST in a lab. Participants enrolled and randomized to the intervention condition to PLUS basically saw reductions in viral load and improvements in CD4 count. And the next steps for PLUS was really to address this in community settings. And the next project is a comparative effectiveness trials to see how this intervention performs in the real world with patients. As you'll note, there are many people here involved in carrying out this research, including colleagues at Mount Sinai who are overseeing the implementation of the interventions. We embedded a formative phase where we really worked with key experts there and collaborators there to fine-tune PLUS in a way that would be very feasible in engaging patients at these clinics. Based on their feedback that alcohol and drug use co-occur and patients tend to underestimate the extent to which alcohol and drugs have an impact on their medication adherence and overall health, and the fact that many factors contribute to substance use, including housing and other factors that place people in vulnerable circumstances, but also that the fact that there are many, many ways to motivate patients. And we also received lots of feedback about the sessions and how they would not be feasible given that they were 8 one-hour sessions. So we modified PLUS to include drug use, ensure that the intervention was flexible enough to deal with any issue that patients would raise during the sessions. And we really focused the intervention content so that we now had 6 sessions that were 45 minutes in length to deal with feasibility issues around provider burden. CHEST is providing ongoing support in terms of training and counseling and providing feedback on the sessions, and this is planned throughout the trial. Enrollment is ongoing, and basically the data from this comparative effectiveness trial will provide evidence about the intervention's effectiveness in the real world. Now, PLUS has mainly focused on the individual level, and based on feedback we gained from our collaborators at Mount Sinai, we really wanted to broaden this framework to include factors at the health system level that could work to treat more patients. The next intervention basically involves a structural level intervention that aims to improve substance abuse. And as you'll see in just a minute, the design of the trial is very, very complex, but the basic premise is very, very basic. And it's a matter of routinely screening HIV positive patients for substance abuse and providing support for recovery and relapse prevention within the context of HIV treatment and care. And it's really just about opening up the conversation and changing norms about routinely making substance abuse part of a routine conversation with providers. The multi-level approach for eye care looks at factors at the individual, health system, and structural levels. And there are several study aims. Right now, we're focusing on the formative work to really develop a brief screening tool that will assist providers in identifying patients in need of substance abuse treatment, and to really develop a plan for training patient health navigators about engaging patients for existing evidence-based programs within Mount Sinai and outside of Mount Sinai that are uniquely matched for each patient. The trial itself is complex, and this is an image of the rollout of the different intervention components because we want to be able to test them very carefully. On your left, we have 2 clinic blocks because, in fact, we have found that the patient populations are different, and some are more similar to others. And the first block of clinics will begin to roll out each intervention component over the course of 2 years. And we will actually examine electronic health records to compare differences between sites to know what is working and what is not working. So based on healthcare reform in the U.S., efforts to really integrate treatment for addiction and provision for healthcare are key. We know that there are many challenges, and we hope that iCare will allow us to collect implementation data to examine the likelihood of full integration of the intervention and its various components into HIV patient care. I want to give a special thank you to Dr. Parsons, who has really served to build the foundation for all of this work and my work. Thank you very much. I want to thank the Chester Mount Sinai team and participants who volunteered their time, as well as the support we received from NIH. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anna. You know, Jeff had mentioned earlier in his presentation, his opening remarks, that they had moved into a lot of work about targeting young gay and bisexual men. So I'm excited about him presenting scaling up interventions to improve the sexual health of young gay and bisexual men. So here's Jeff.
Readjust this down here. Okay, so we definitely see the need for HIV prevention efforts among young people. If you look at the most recent sort of statistics looking at diagnosed HIV infections from 2010 to 2014, 80% are in males, and of those, 80% are attributed to male sexual contact. We're also seeing increases among young men who have sex with men, both in the 13 to 24-year-old group and also the group slightly older than that, that it's quite possible they became infected in the younger stage but are just not getting tested until later on. So if you look, this is from 2006 to 2009, and this is where we really started to see shifts in the age demographic among men who have sex with men and HIV infection. And so what you see is that this 13 to 24-year-old group increasing over just that four-year period. And you also see the 25 to 34-year-old group increasing. If you notice, the 35 to 44-year-old group is actually going down. If you follow this out from, this is 2006 to 2009, if you then carry over from 2010 to 2014, you now see that that 25 to 34-year-old group is at the top, and the 13 to 24-year-old group is just behind them. And again, because of the potential for delay between infection and testing and identification, it's quite possible that a lot of those people in the 25 to 34-year-old group were actually infected while they were in the 13 to 24 age range. So this is a critical population for us to address efforts. There's also a major disproportional rate going on with regard to young men who have sex with men of color. So if you see particularly Black and African American young men who have sex with men are the group primarily being affected. Not to say that the other groups are not in need and have unique needs, but particularly African American young men who have sex with men need targeted intervention strategies for us to deal with the rates of infection in this population. We started focusing on emerging adults, and there was a few reasons for that. And by emerging adults, we refer to this 18 to 29-year-old age range, which sort of crosses a couple of those age categories. In part because of the rates in those categories that we see, this is also a really unique developmental period. My original training was as a developmental psychologist in emerging adulthood, so I sort of have always kind of felt really comfortable looking at this age grouping. One of the things that makes them very unique is that they've got this sort of adult status, but a lot of them have not really assumed the roles and responsibilities of adulthood. A lot of them delay responsibilities of adulthood by going to college, going to graduate school, doing postdocs, whatever you can to sort of delay your adulthood responsibilities. And so it's an important group to consider because they've got some unique developmental issues going on that can be dealt with. So we, from 2006 to 2011, did what we called the Young Men's Health Project. And this was an intervention that really stemmed from some of the earlier formative work that was done at CHEST that saw very clear indications of substance use being related to condomless sex in this population. And so we really wanted to develop and deliver an intervention that had a dual focus. Don't just focus on the drugs, don't just focus on the condoms, focus on both. And specifically, at the time that this study was going on, club drugs were the big thing. And so it had a specific focus on club drug use among these young men. So it was a randomized controlled trial, and we were testing a brief four-session risk reduction intervention, which was either four sessions of motivational interviewing focused on both behaviors, or four factual education sessions focused on the intersection of substance use and HIV. Now, the first thing that people who do intervention trials are going to note here is, why on earth would you have such a strong control group and comparison group? Because we are attention matched, time matched, and we are focus matched. That is, we're not comparing our four-session intervention to something about nutrition and diet. It's comparing two interventions, both focused on the same aspects, same amount of time, same amount of intensity. Because our argument was, if we can't do better than basic education and factual information about the very behaviors that are important to this population, then what's the point of taking an intervention and implementing it eventually in real-world settings? So we wanted very much to have that kind of strong comparison group to really be able to say that our intervention is worth doing. So the aims were to reduce both the drug use and the sexual risk among non-treatment-seeking HIV-negative young MSM ages 18 to 29 in New York City. So we recruited and enrolled youth from 2007 to 2010. They would come to our offices at CHEST for a baseline assessment to confirm their eligibility. Then they'd be randomized to one of the two intervention arms, and then we'd follow them up every 3 months for a year to sort of monitor the behavior change over time. Recruitment, we put a lot of effort into recruitment, and this was sort of in an era when CHEST was, we had really come from this field-based recruitment approach where we would send recruiters out in the field, we would send the divas out in the field to do recruitment. We would really kind of do literally legwork recruitment. So walking the streets, going into bars, going into clubs, going into places where the population is likely to be found, and sort of letting people know about our projects through that way. But we also then, this was the era of the internet, and so we also shifted to a lot of online recruitment. And so we tried out different techniques, different banner ads, different approaches to online recruitment. We were very sophisticated with our recruitment images and materials. We had these very glossy, beautiful brochures that we would leave at HIV testing places and at community-based organizations, which would, you know, explain, you know, what is our study? What can you expect when you become a participant? Sort of that information that, you know, particularly medical centers and clinics like to have. It's like, if we're going to let people into our research study, they should sort of know what they're getting into. So it was very informative and all of that. But what really worked best at actually getting men to call and screen and participate was this card. Got blow. At the time, cocaine was the most commonly used drug in this population, and just this single recruitment card or image and tagline produced more participants than all of the other sort of sophisticated approaches to recruitment that we came up with. So when all else fails, got blow. Oh, that was baby powder, yeah. So I was told. So why MI-based prevention with this population? Well, first of all, motivational interviewing is a widely used therapeutic technique, particularly now. At the time, it was still gaining prominence, but now it's certainly widespread. It's really successful in reducing a variety of risk behaviors and increasing desirable outcomes. And so we liked it because it could be applied to both the drug use and the sexual risk practices. It's really considered evidence-based at this point because there's enough data to suggest that it does work in a variety of situations. The other reason we really liked it is because it can be delivered by a variety of providers. So there's maximizing the flexibility of it, especially as we now, as you'll see, are moving into implementation work with this. So the goals were to provide information. If they didn't already have that information, we really felt that they needed it in this condition. The other condition was getting exclusively information, but we wanted them to get some as well. to enhance their motivation and personal responsibility, and to assess their stage of change and then individually tailor the intervention based on that. There was goal setting and behavior change plans when appropriate, and it was a much more structured intervention than sort of just MI, if you will. Now, our providers were very sort of higher level providers because this is an efficacy trial in a very controlled environment. So they were all master's level, MSWs, postdocs, graduate students in clinical. They had a lot of training. We did a lot of training, a lot of ongoing supervision, and a lot of fidelity monitoring to make sure that what they were delivering was actually MI. So we put 143 young men through this intervention, fairly diverse with regard to race and ethnicity. You see, we definitely skewed a little bit older. We only had about 10% who were that 18 to 20-year-old group. Most of them were single and identified as gay, variability with regard to education and income. So what we saw, this is the effects on substance use, is that over time, both conditions got better, but the MI condition got significantly better than the education condition. And we really started to see that even later on in the process, so at the 6-month and 9-month outcomes. Similar results for condomless anal sex. Everybody got better, but the MI group significantly better than the education group. And to sort of give you specific numbers to that, the 4 sessions of MI resulted in a 26% reduction in drug use days and a 51% reduction in condomless anal sex, whereas education only resulted in 19% and 38%. Still good. I mean, we want education to work, and it did work for some folks, but the MI worked better. And the differential rates were significant. So we saw an 18% greater reduction in drug use and a 24% greater reduction in condomless anal sex. So Anna mentioned this, and some people have described this sort of research to practice gap as a 17-year process, from sort of deciding what you're going to do to actually getting it out there. We're trying to do it in less than 17 years. That's our goal with this one. So we've started to do a lot of adaptation. We've already updated it to include a focus on PrEP rather than exclusively focusing on condom use. We've started testing it with adolescents under the age of 18, and we've started testing it through alternative deliveries to face-to-face in person. We did some pilot testing with 10 youth. 7 of them completed all 4 of the sessions, and we've started to do qualitative interviews to kind of understand how did the adaptation work and what might still be needed to be done. So to adapt it for younger youth, we found that we had to let the participants focus on additional topics. So the interventionists were given permission to talk about information about sex in general, not just about condom use. These youth, especially under 18, they want to talk to somebody about sex in general. Just tell me about gay sex. Relationship skills. They all want to talk about how do you find a partner. We didn't necessarily see these kinds of things as the areas of focus in the emerging adults, but when you drop below 18, these become the salient issues for the youth. Balancing the relationships with existing relationships, these types of things. The younger MSM really have a need for basic education around sex and sexuality. They're not getting it in their schools. So they try to get it from the counselors in our study. And so we allowed the discussions to not just be about sexual safety, but general sexual health as well. How do you have good sex? What can you expect during sex? We also discovered a really heightened salience of family factors that, again, we don't see with our older populations. The parents of kids under the age of 18 are playing a role in regulating their son's life, more so than we've seen before. And again, finding partners, boyfriends, major priority. We tried some different technology adaptations with limited success. I think we've learned some ways to improve it going forward. We did adapt some of the activities for electronic delivery, and that worked fine. One of our challenges was finding private spaces where our therapists could actually do this kind of work. In a busy office setting where people are more cubicle-based than private offices, but also planning with the youth so that they were in a private setting, so that their mother wasn't going to walk in the middle of talking about their condom use and that sort of stuff. And when you're doing it over the phone, where you don't necessarily have the kind of face-to-face cues that you get in person, really kind of trying to understand what's maybe not being said. Youth preferred to talk to us by phone rather than through Skype or other video chat. And we're hoping to address that in the future by allowing their first couple of sessions maybe to be by phone, then asking them to move to video. It may be very strange to all of a sudden be doing a video chat with some strange therapist that you've never met before, but maybe after a couple of sessions on the phone, you'd gain some comfort and be able to do that. We also have to schedule this to accommodate school hours. We're not used to that. These kids go to school. How dare they? And guess what? Young people confirm an appointment and then cancel. Damn youth. So our next steps are, we're testing this in the two CBOs, as I talked about earlier, really looking at, can we have this delivered by peer counselors? Will it be the same when sort of put in the real world? The SMART project is testing it with this really younger group, the 13 to 18-year-olds, including youth who don't live in urban settings, trying to utilize FaceTime and Skype. And then through the Adolescent Trials Network, we're going to deliver it in clinic settings, and we're going to test phone versus face-to-face to see if we have differential effects. So I want to acknowledge all the folks who have worked on this project, and that's it for me.
Thanks, Jeff. Now, having heard from these four very capable researchers, because the theme of this particular session is research informing policy, we will now be hearing from Dr. James Tesserario, just in the nick of time, and who will be kind of remarking as a policy person on what he's just heard. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to say it's great to be here today. You know, I'm probably one of the few people from policy that actually enjoys research. I spent years doing it before I went to prevention, and then now I'm in epidemiology. So I guess I'm the right guy, you know, to talk about this. I was asked to do three things. Talk about how research can influence policy, specifically give an example or so of how we at the State Health Department are doing that, and then maybe what's left to be done. So I'll do that in maybe 5 minutes and then spend a minute or two talking about the research that we just heard about and some ideas that I had, you know, about how we might do better or more with that in terms of translating that into something that we're doing at the state, for example. So I think, you know, it's funny when you think about it, what could be more important than doing this research to, you know, improve the health and well-being of people living with this disease or people prevent people from getting it? So, I mean, researchers do that for that express purpose. And we, as policy people, I mean, that's our primary job, too, is to improve the health of New Yorkers. So we should be completely married in what we're doing. And yet, you know, it really doesn't happen nearly the way it should. And it doesn't take long to figure out why when you look at the stressors of our jobs, right? So all the things that academics and researchers have to do, you know, pressures to publish, teaching, the requirements of NIH funding, which sometimes don't translate into practical real-world research. Our stressors that we have to deal with, you know, when I was a director of prevention, I had a $75 million grant that I had to deal with, you know, getting out grants that I had to get out. My primary job was contract management. 95% of my job was just making sure, you know, you're plugging holes, stopping fires, dealing with problem providers. Very little time to actually step back and say, you know, are we even implementing the right programming? So it's really not that hard to think about, and yet what could be more important? So that has to do with nothing, but just an intro into what I want to talk about a little bit. I do think that of all the times this is the best time to sort of work together to sort of implement research, because it happens. First of all, we've been trending this way anyway over the 25 years I've been at the AIDS Institute. I started out in a three-person research unit. Nobody wanted to deal with me at all. And so now I actually am allowed to come here and talk to people. So we've come a long way. But I think we're really in a great position for other reasons, too, because we've got this governor's initiative to end the epidemic by end of 2020. And what that's done is create tremendous pressure on us. So we can't get away with just implementing our grants anymore. You know, now we have to answer to weekly calls from the governor's office. How are we on incidence? You know, it's the worst indicator of all to be tracking, but that's the one we have to talk about. You know, how are we doing with MSM programming? We're not reaching young MSM of color. And we hear this week after week after week. And so we're under tremendous pressure to sort of get things done. Fortunately, there's new tools at our advance. We have PrEP. We have PEP. We have molecular genetics, which we can use. We have the ability to share surveillance data. So we have a lot of new tools, which is really exciting. We also have pressure. So I think this is the time to do it. This is the time to take this research and the research that you all are doing, the policy and finances that we're doing, and marry it together to do better public health as it's implemented. And I know that The New York City Health Department feels the same way. I know Dimitri will be here at some point today if he's not here already, so I think this is the right time. Just one example, Bob Ramian's here. He and I worked on a grant together, Positive Pathways. It was a 3-year project, and you know, we did many things. We looked at the role, and it was done in the correctional facility. We looked at the role stigma plays on disclosure of HIV. We did some other things as well. But between the research that we did over that 3-year period, we realized that virtually all HIV-positive persons in the New York State correctional system already know they're HIV-positive. And yet our programming spent 30 to 40% of its resources on the agencies we funded for HIV testing. So what we're doing in the next round of funding out of our criminal justice initiative is we'll obviously be de-emphasizing testing and spending much more time on day-to-day care work. That RFA will be out soon. So just one very concrete example of how we've taken research and actually is altering, you know, an $8 million RFA, which will be coming out in the near future. Let's see. In terms of what still needs to be done, I think, as I said, we are under pressure, so this is a great time to do it. I think what we need to do is work together a little bit more up front. So oftentimes, researchers will call me or call Joanne Moore and our AIDS Institute director or Dan O'Connell before him and her, and they'll want to meet and we'll already have a sort of an idea completely formalized, maybe a grant application, something like that, or an actual evidence-based study that they want us to sort of help them implement. And while that's okay, it would be much better to sort of partner with us, I think, you know, before that, so we could conceptualize a project that sort of met both of our needs. And I think on our end, you know, what we need to do is actually take that step back and take a look at what we're doing a little more systematically and say, hey, you know what, we have no idea if this works. Let's look for researchers in this particular field and bring them in and see the extent to which their existing research or maybe research going forward could help us figure this out. Because at one point when I was the director of prevention, I realized that we spent 40-something percent of our resources on interventions that really weren't evidence-based, or at least we couldn't prove that were evidence-based. So we worked to change that, but that was a real issue, and that wasn't that many years ago. Let me just, actually I got 2 minutes, so let me just talk a little bit about the 4 studies. I think the first study on the condom size study, Dr. Grove, one idea I had, you know, as a way to, how could we take what you've done or perhaps and take it one step further? And so, you know, there's the New York City condom program, there's also the New York State condom program. And, you know, we offer multiple condoms, different sizes, different colors, different everything. And yet, you know, maybe one way to take this further, if you've got enough research for it, would be to create a user guide or an implementation guide for somebody who wants to purchase condoms, so that you could say, "Hey, my condom is, or my penis is like this. You know, it's this big. It looks like this. Try these condoms because our research shows these condoms might work well for you." You know, so actually a user guide that could help fit a person to a condom. So we could potentially, if the research were sound and we could sell it, we could actually include that with our condom, you know, purchases. We ship them out to agencies, and you know, who knows? That might actually be a great idea, because if you get a condom and it doesn't fit, you might never try it again. So that's just one quick idea. And I think for the other 3 studies, I think that the behavioral interventions that you guys are doing, they're already evidence-based. And so as we fund our providers now, there's a requirement that they use evidence-based interventions. So if they're doing behavioral interventions, they need to be evidence-based, either CDC endorsed or we have like 15 common elements that they have to meet. And so those are requirements. So I don't know about ideas for taking this a step further. Maybe, you know, it would be great if somehow the researchers would be able to provide technical assistance, or, you know, maybe we could fund that down the road, or, you know, some way where we could, because who knows what happens when it gets out in the field. And, you know, maybe, you know, the taking it to that last step after you've got the evidence-based intervention and you want to roll it out, it's still pretty dirty when it's rolled out from, you know, the way that we do it. And so figuring out ways to study that further would be something I'd be interested in. And so maybe we could, you know, get together and talk about how to do that differently. That's a whole lot of random thoughts, but hopefully that was somehow can hear it. All right, well, thank you.
Everybody here? Are we missing? Oh, please, join us. We're not done.
Hi, so we're already pressed for time. We have 5 minutes before our scheduled break. I might push that another 5 minutes and next time be a little harsher on the speakers and maybe trim a minute off of here or there. Two quick questions, though, in the few minutes that we have. My first one is going to be about implementation. The second one is about substance abuse, so in case you want to kind of consider that. But I was director of education and outreach for a community-based aid service organization. Never in the years that I was there did anybody ever call me on the phone and say, hey, I have this great research model. We've been working on it, and we think you should implement. I don't know. I don't read journals. I have no idea. And, of course, the theme of this session is on research to policy. And I would say even further, research to policy to community-based interventions that for instance, your thing, David, looked a lot like. You know, you're doing research, but it also looks a lot like something that a community-based organization could actually adopt. Several of your things did. So my question is, and Anna, you talked about the unrequited love affair between research and policy and all of that. How do we get there? Where's the straight line between research and the policy people involved in the Department of Health, like the very... James told us, and then even community-based organizations who need this kind of direction and ideas.
Wow. So, am I on? I don't think I'm. No, I'm not green. I'm red. I think I have a low battery. I think one of the first, most basic, simplest approaches is to just actually ask to have conversations. I think that for a long time in New York, and I suspect that this is true in other areas, there was this real distrust of researchers. I think that in the early stages of the epidemic, researchers went into community-based organizations, kind of got what they needed, i.e. data, and then took their data and went home and wrote papers about it. And I think it left a bad taste in the mouths of community-based organizations who were like, what just happened here? And so I think just having the conversations, we've found that when we reach out to CBOs and say, hey, we have this idea, we'd really like to get your feedback on it, we'd really like your input in it, that they really welcome the idea. Now what they don't want, and I think rightly so, is for us to come in and say, here's a 9-page proposal where we've already made every decision, we just want you to sign a letter of support for it. That's not gonna fly, but really engaging them early in the formative process, I think you can have these kinds of relationships where you can then get the work into the field more quickly.
And what I've seen, and especially with PLUS, I mean, as Jeff said, it was very, very easy to begin that conversation. Within a health system, I think what was really crucial was to do it early on, to approach and engage folks about different ideas for interventions. And so, for example, at Mount Sinai, really the key experts have become very, very invested in ensuring that from a practice perspective, things really align, and especially around patient needs and in dealing with substance abuse and engaging them in care.
So are you suggesting that you find your community partners as part of your research, so that maybe then you can leave something behind when you're done?
Or not leave. I mean, you know, the other option is to not leave, to stay engaged with them, to then move into the technical assistance process, to then add a training component so that you actually train them to do what it is you've developed and tested in a way that's going to make it sustainable.
And really, it's a two-way relationship because we end up learning a lot from them, and it really... the work ends up evolving over time. It's just the nature of it.
I'd like to chime in. I think a really important thing that we've kind of talked around but haven't addressed directly is that you really need to go out into the community. It's helpful to have members of the community as part of your team. I think a lot of the work that we did at CHEST emanated from a bunch of LGBT folks sitting around a conference room table saying, what's going on? You know, this crystal meth thing is going on. I think we need to do a quick survey of this. So a lot of it was community-based research coming from community members who just happened to be research scientists. But we also need to check in with the mainstream community, if you will, about what they're interested in. We can design an intervention and the community doesn't want to hear it. We didn't talk today about the T-Girls project that we had developed several years ago, and it was an HIV intervention, but we didn't sell it like that because the community didn't want an HIV intervention. They wanted an intervention addressing their needs, and HIV was just one of them. So we have to work with the community to find out what they want, what they're interested in, what methods work. Got Blow was very effective. Right, drag queens work.
Okay, by the way, I know that wasn't cocaine. I knew that was powdered sugar as soon as I saw it. and some of you probably did too. I'm just saying. Okay.
But I'm just saying, you know, yes. whatever works. I mean, but we are under constraints of policies and governments and what people are funding. You know, no one's going to pay for, you know, naked porn stars to make
because
people,
not only
you know,
may they be funding happen. Your research, but are they funding the program as it exists at that agency? Because they need funding to run it.
We did several small applications to get funding to have the Divas be a regular appearance in the New York nightlife scene, and we got rejected at every turn.
Probably better for our careers.
Better, yeah.
In the few minutes we have left, I do want to ask about the substance abuse component that several of you touched upon. You know, I mentioned that I was a director of AIDS education at an agency. Within 3 years after that, I was an unemployed, daily, intravenous crystal meth drug addict. That's how fast it happened. And so clearly this is something that I'm very interested in, and I'm wondering, two questions about the substance abuse. One is, do we need some sort of statewide Department of Health plan a la the campaign to ending the AIDS epidemic in New York? Is that the level of do we need? And how do you catch people prevention-wise before that? Because I'll tell you, I was the last guy that would have considered doing something like that, and then bang, there I was. So how do we scoop people up beforehand, and what kind of level of intervention do we need? Should it be something like the same plan as we have for New York AIDS?
So based on what we're seeing as part of integrated care at Mount Sinai is that we first want to ensure that treatment services that are evidence-based and that have shown some efficacy and will help to improve services for patients at Mount Sinai, that those are sort of being prioritized first. I completely agree with you that prevention should also be in our minds, right? And so there are ways through integrating screening tools around substance abuse to identify folks in the continuum of substance use, right? So it may not be abuse yet, it may not be reaching levels of abuse, but you could engage people at earlier levels for prevention purposes. Right now, the treatment and especially identifying really good evidence-based programs to match to patient needs based on the type of drug being used, administration, and so forth, is really, really key. And I do think a concerted effort to the level of that we've seen around the ending the HIV epidemic in New York is necessary. We have a substance abuse epidemic, some of which is related to the treatment of pain early on in the HIV epidemic. And so we find ourselves in a cycle, and for HIV-positive patients, it's especially important.
And self-medication for long-term survivors who are traumatized. James, it may not be even fair to say that the campaign to end AIDS in New York State doesn't even address substance abuse. There may be a component of that.
No, there definitely. I mean, there definitely is. I should have said the AIDS Institute actually focuses on drug user health, STD, and LGBT health as well. And so there's a major substance use component to that. We've increased by about $5 million our drug user health component. We've recently expanded our unit within the AIDS Institute that addresses drug user health. Our opiate overdose prevention program, all of our naloxone training has grown from nothing to a multi-million dollar initiative. And yet, we're nowhere near getting a handle on this epidemic. It continues to grow. Overdose death rates continue to skyrocket throughout the country, and New York State is doing better on average than other states, but we are clearly
not heading in the right direction. And so I think an initiative, a governor's initiative, there's already a governor's initiative, attorney general's initiative on combating heroin abuse. And but I think transforming that into something, coalescing that into something even more, and this community could embrace it because we've got a history of doing it. And so I think that's going to happen. I mean, we're heading in that direction right now. And so what we need, in fact, we're getting pressure. All the overdose programming that we're doing around naloxone kits worked. It was great for about a year. And now the next question we're getting is, well, what are you going to do with these people? It's great that you're saving them from overdoses, and then they're going back out and you're seeing them next week and you're reversing another overdose. It's time for effective treatment. And so that's where we are.
I wanted to pick up on what Anna had said, Anna's study speaking to is the fact that we need to do good provider education for substance abuse, a meaningful substance abuse screening when your people are accessing, whether it's direct medical care or social support services, because many times there's a checklist, did you use, and someone's looking down. No one's really doing an effective sort of screening. I mean, I've seen an LGB provider, and it's like, oh, well, and we just do our thing. But, are people really engaging with a real meaningful screening? And then addressing the syndemic issues that you alluded to is that LGBT folks have microaggressions, we live in this hostile environment, and then we wonder why people wind up acting out or developing compulsions, addictions, or substance abuse problems.
Believe it or not, we've had all this excitement already today. We're only 7 minutes behind, which is actually pretty good. But I'm going to have to stop it. I wish we could continue talking, and certainly you'll have a chance to chat during our coffee break, which is happening now, which upstairs in the next level, one level up? First floor, which is one level up? Two levels up. I got no idea. And so we will see you. Feel free to, yes.
So our next panel, we have one less speaker than we had for this one. So we are going to push the beginning of the next panel back for 5 minutes. We will begin at 3:05, promptly at 3:05, back in this room. So please take your coffee break and be here at 3:05. Thank you.